And overseas, it blew my knee out. I was trying to shoot him. Doc, coach is like, you never can't get rebound from me anymore because I wasn't on contract. And I wanted to shoot a baseline three, and all they had was those one-dimensional either shooting machines or pitchbacks. And I was thinking to myself, if I'm shooting a baseline three, I'm not getting the ball from the net, right? I'm getting the ball from where you are, coming off a curl cut. So why would I practice getting the ball like that? I mean, once in a while, someone will get an offensive rebound to kick it out, but it's unrealistic. Post players have never had this option ever. Where like, you know, you're the post, so you can like maybe hook left. Now I'm over here, I can maybe hook right. I can reverse pivot, I can turn around more. I can finish on the break, you know, finish this side. Now I can come back and I can finish. Yeah, I've done everything I wanted to do in the game. Even the big players forward, you know, reading the screen, send it back, hit that shot, you know? Like, you know, you could do two ball passing where you work on your peripheral. You know, just think about how many times in a game players they can't even pass with their right hand or left hand, like both hands anymore. You know, they could work on staying low, getting both angles. Just imagine if you could come make a move, come down the break, pass it with your left hand perfectly, turn, square, and shoot.
IU Hillel would really love to welcome everyone and to thank you very much for being here tonight. And we are so fortunate that Tamir Goodman, who was dubbed as the Jewish Jordan by Sports Illustrated, and maybe he can explain a little bit more about that, is here. We'd like to thank Hineni and International Hillel for making Tamir's visit possible. And with Hineni and International Hillel, and there's a partnership with the Israel Education Center out of Chicago and the JUF and International Hillel, we've got some amazing, exciting, really, really exciting speakers coming on. We're hoping to bring Dennis Ross in the next semester, and numbers of cultural and different singers and possibly comedians. And we're going to make it as part of our Israel Fellows series, which you'll hear a little bit more about, and part of our Hoosier for Israel group, which is organizing this. We'd like to thank our co-sponsors of this event, Hoosiers for Israel, which is one of our clubs, and then Union Board, and then also with Hillel International again, with the Hutton Honors College, with Students Supporting Israel, with Stand With Us, and then with ZBT, with AEPI, with SDT, and with AEFI. And I'd like to just introduce Oren from Hineinu, because he works closely with Yotam and with how many Israel Fellows across the country?
There are 72.
72 Israel Fellows across
the
country.
And the goal is 100.
Now, what I want to do is ask Yotam to come up, our Israel Fellow, and he'll tell you a little bit about himself, and then he'll tell you about our headliner over there. Right.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming here. It's really a pleasure to have you here. I'm the Israel Fellow. If you have any question about Israel, Israel education, anything, just come and see me. But more than that, I want to introduce for you the one that's called the Jewish Jordan, Tamir Goodman. Please come over. Tamir is playing for 9 years as a professional basketball player in Israel. Tamir also was the first Jewish to get a scholarship and play with the kippah on the court. And now it's Shabbat, Saturday. Please.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. This is a very, very special day for me because I grew up loving Indiana basketball. You can see my jersey. I wore number 22. And the reason I wore number 22, my brother also wore it, but the reason we wore 22 was for Damon Bailey. He wore 22, he was a star at Indiana. We love the way that he played, and that's why I wore 22, and it was very special for me to be here. I also want to thank everybody that made this possible, and thank you so much. I've only been here for a day, but I feel very welcome and part of a family already, so thank you to everyone that made that possible, and a very special thank you to Hillel International. So, when I was about 10, 11 years old, I decided that I wanted to be a professional basketball player, and I was very lucky that there was a coach who lived a couple blocks away from us. So I would jog in the morning in front of his house and hope that he'd be outside, and if he was outside, maybe he could teach me a couple of drills. So I would jog, and if he wasn't in his living room, I'd just go to the stop sign and turn around and hope he'd be there. And then eventually I'd catch his attention, and he'd come outside and give me a couple of drills. And we established a very nice connection, and I would work very, very, very hard towards my goal of becoming a professional basketball player. But I had my big breakthrough when I was 16 years old. Because when I was 16 years old, I got invited to my first ever invitational basketball camp. An invitational basketball camp is a camp where they invite high school recruits to play against each other, but they also invite college coaches to come watch you play. So if you play well at an invitational camp, you can get what's called an athletic scholarship to go play college basketball, which was my dream. So I walk into registration first day, and I just looked completely different than the other players there. You see, most of the players there were 6'8", over 7 feet tall, with a lot of muscles, and they really looked like basketball players. I walked into this basketball camp, I was only 6'3", zero muscles, a big kippah, long TC, and a cooler of kosher food that my parents had packed for me. And that's how I walked into this basketball camp. And I can remember one of the players coming over to me and say, "Are you lost? Did you not know that this was an invitational camp? How did you get to this camp?" But I was able to overcome it, and I would even receive some anti-Semitic comments, but I decided I was just going to play hard. Camp was only 1 week long. On Sunday, not one college coach came to watch me play. On Monday, the same thing. Tuesday, the same thing. By Tuesday evening, I was getting a little bit nervous because everybody doubted me. Everyone told me before I went to the camp back in Maryland where I grew up, "You're never going to be able to play a college basketball player. You're never going to be a pro basketball player." And here it is, Tuesday evening of the camp. Camp's only 1 week long, and not one college coach has had any interaction with me. So I had a big blessing that night, that Tuesday night, because I went over to my coach and I said, "Coach, which one of the 15 courts are we playing on tonight?" Throughout the whole week, we played on one of 15 courts outside. He said, "Actually, we're not playing outdoors tonight, we're playing indoors inside the main gym." I grab my sneakers and I go inside the gym, and the game starts, and all of a sudden, more and more players are coming into the gym, and more college coaches are coming into the gym. And the first time out, the coach explained to me, and to the team, he said, "Listen, I just got word it started raining outside. All the 15 courts, all the games, all the gyms, everyone's coming inside to watch us play." Because we were playing indoors that night. So, after the timeout, the major part of the basketball world is now watching our team play. This kid comes down the court from the other team. He stops at the free throw line, he shoots, he misses a jump shot. I jump up, I grab a rebound. Now I'm going to lead my team on a fast break to the other end of the court. It's just one dribble. And instead of throwing a regular pass, I don't know what I was thinking. I threw the ball the length of the court behind my back like that. My teammate caught it and he dumped it in. The place went crazy. "Did you see what that Jewish kid just did?" And that pass changed my life, because that was the first time that the college coaches looked at me as a potential Division I basketball player. Thank God my talent came out more on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday morning. The owner of the camp comes running down to the court where I was playing and said, "Tamir, when you first came here, you were a curiosity, but I'm here to invite you to play in the All-Star game tomorrow on national TV as one of the top players in the camp." I was 16 years old, and I said, "Coach, thank you so much for the opportunity, but I can't play in the All-Star game tomorrow because I'll play basketball on Shabbat. I'm Jewish." He said, "Did you understand what I just told you? You're going to be in the All-Star game tomorrow on national TV." I said, "I'm sorry, I can't." And just as I told him that, my high school coach pulled up in his car and drove me back to Maryland so that I'd make it home in time for Shabbat. And as he was driving me home, that was the first time in my life that I realized, you know what? There may be a lot of challenges, maybe some anti-Semitic comments. People may make fun of me. People may doubt me. But at the end of the day, I think I'm going to be able to fulfill my dream. This camp gave me a lot of koach, as we say in Hebrew, a lot of power moving forward. And that took me into 11th grade. When I was in 11th grade, I was ranked the 25th best player in the nation. I was averaging almost 40 points a game, and I started getting scholarship offers in the mail every day. However, having grown up in Maryland, the University of Maryland, at that time, had one of the best basketball programs in the nation. They called up my high school coach, and they said, "We're coming to watch Tamir Goodman play." And I was very excited because I grew up in Maryland and no one from my school ever played college basketball, ever in the history of the school. And all of a sudden, the University of Maryland was coming to watch me play. Well, after one game, the University of Maryland was so impressed, they offered me a 4-year full athletic scholarship to join their basketball program. And I looked at my high school coach and I said, what else should I wait for? I love Maryland. I can stay close to home. I'm going to commit to Maryland, but I'm only going to commit on one condition, that I'm never going to play on Shabbat. So in this picture right here that you see, we met with the coaching staff at Maryland. And about 1 minute before that picture, they said that they would try to accommodate me and there wouldn't be any issue with Shabbat. Boom, my life changes overnight. I had 700 media requests that week. ABC, NBC, CBS, Jerry Seinfeld in a full skit about Saturday Night Live. Howard Stern called my house, but my parents didn't let me do the interview. Things start to move very quickly, but one thing in the media had a bigger impact than everything else, and that's when Sports Illustrated magazine called up. Sports Illustrated came, called us up, and they said they were coming to watch me play. And they were so impressed with what they saw that they nicknamed me the Jewish Michael Jordan, and they said they were going to put a 4-page article about me in Sports Illustrated. So they sent an NBA photographer to my house, and he asked me to start taking jump shots. We had a hoop in my backyard, so I started shooting, and he's taking a lot of pictures. About 5 minutes into the photo shoot, I stopped the photographer and I said, Mr. Photographer, I know you take a lot of pictures of basketball players, but I'm not a regular basketball player. I'm a Jewish basketball player. And I really want to represent Israel and the Jewish people through this media attention. I know that millions of people are going to see this. This isn't really about me. This is about something much bigger than myself. So he said, how can you do that? So I said, please follow me down to my room. He came down to my room. And even though I'd already prayed that morning, I took out my prayer book and I took out my tefillin and I put them back on and said, well, this is how I pray every day. And he took a picture of it, and I became the first person ever to be featured in Sports Illustrated with my tefillin and my prayer book, nicknamed the Jewish Jordan, when I was only 17 years old. I cannot tell you how much this picture has changed my life. Till today, almost everywhere I go, somebody will stop me and say, are you the Jewish Jordan? I remember the picture of you in Sports Illustrated. So seemingly my life was great. I had the best family, the best team, the best friends. Everything was perfect. But all of a sudden, two huge challenges came my way at the end of my junior year of high school. Number one, my high school asked me to leave for my senior year of high school because the media was so relentless that it became a distraction to the school. The cameras would follow me into class in the morning. They would follow me home from practice. They even came to my synagogue on Friday night. So that was my first big challenge. My second big challenge towards the end of 11th grade was I was already training with the University of Maryland, playing pickup with the team every night. And one day after practice, coach calls me into his office and he's like, look, Tamir, it's almost time for you to come on campus. And we decided that based on the way we project you as a player and how we see things moving forward, we've decided that you can stay here. You have a scholarship, but if you're gonna stay here, you're gonna have to play on Shabbat. So I had to make this decision. Should I play on Shabbat or not play on Shabbat? And I just looked at the coach on the spot and I said, coach, thank you so much for the opportunity. I love the University of Maryland and the basketball program, but for Jewish people, Shabbat is more important than basketball. And I gave him that. Probably the most sought after basketball scholarship in the nation, because I didn't want to play basketball on Shabbat. They went on to win the national championship. I would have been on the national championship team. So here I am going into my senior year of high school, no senior year of high school, and I just gave my scholarship back, but I had Shabbat. And my parents always told me that if you take care of Shabbat, Shabbat will take care of you. And that's exactly what happened. First off, where was I going to go for my senior year of high school? I could not find a school that accommodated me until one day I get a phone call from a Christian priest. Christian priest calls me up and says, Tamir, I'd love for you to come to our school for our senior year of high school. I said, why? I'm Jewish. What am I going to do in a Christian school? He says, listen, our gym seats 5,000 people, so you won't have issues like you had in a small gym at the other school. We'll take all of your credits. And because we are Seventh-day Adventist Christians, we don't play basketball on Shabbat either.
Most Christians, their Shabbat is on Sunday. Seventh-day Adventist Christians don't play basketball on Shabbat. So, for my senior year of high school, I transferred from all boys yeshiva to a predominantly African-American Christian school in Washington, D.C. Orthodox student transfers to Christian Academy. So, when I first got to the Christian school, it was very, very hard for me. Okay? I was the only Jewish kid in the whole school, every day wearing my kippah and my tzitzit. But the Christian school ended up being a great blessing for me because academically I grew, athletically I grew. We played a much harder competition, much better teams than I did at the Jewish school. So much so that at the end of my senior year of high school, at the Christian school, I got invited to play in a very prestigious All-Star game called the Capital Classic All-Star Game. The Capital Classic All-Star Game features the best players in the nation. Over the years, some of the players have competed in the game include Michael Jordan, Magic Johnson, Patrick Ewing, Graham Hill. Some of the greatest players of all time got invited to play in this game. I was the first Jewish person to ever get invited to play in this prestigious game. But not only did I get invited to play in the game, I won the most valuable player of the game against the top players in the nation, and I tied Jason Kidd's assist record in the game. So, I didn't know at first why I went to the Christian school, but looking back, this would have never happened had I not gone to the Christian school. But, as you can remember, I gave my scholarship back. Senior year of high school was over, where am I going to play in college? So I had a very big miracle happen to me. Towson University, it's a Division I school in Baltimore, Maryland, called me up. And the coach says, "Hi, I'm not Jewish." That's the first thing he says on the phone. But the guys on the team asked me to come recruit you. They heard what happened with you in Maryland, and they respect that. Can I learn more about your religion? So we said, sure. We invited the coaching staff over our house. My father, of blessed memory, had the head coach, assistant coach sit down, and he comes out of the kitchen with a Jewish calendar, my father. And he tells the coach, Rosh Hashanah, can't play. Coach writes it down. Yom Kippur, can't play. Coach writes it down. Shabbat, he went through the whole Jewish calendar, and the coach put together a proposal and said, is there any way you can change the entire schedule for one Jewish athlete that can't play on Shabbat or the Jewish holidays? You're talking about flights, TV contracts, schedules, like an absolute unbelievable request. And he wears a kippah when he plays. And they agreed. And I became the first person to play on a full Division I athletic scholarship without having to play on Shabbat or any Jewish holidays. This article was in ESPN magazine. They were speechless. They even admitted answered prayer. And I was so excited to live out my dream. So I walked on campus and I gave Coach a huge hug. I said, Coach, thank you so much for changing the schedule for me. This was going to be impossible, and here I am playing college basketball. I'm so excited. He says, perfect timing. I said, why? He says, I want you to meet someone. So look on the other side of his office, and I see a 6'10" basketball player. So Coach says, I want you to meet Muhammad. I said, nice to meet you, Muhammad. Coach says, you know, I was thinking, you guys are both incoming freshmen. You guys are both on the basketball team. Tamir, you're Jewish. Muhammad, you're a Muslim. I thought you guys would be perfect roommates together. So in 2 years, I went from all-boys yeshiva to graduating from predominantly African-American Christian school to rooming with Muhammad at Towson University. But Muhammad and my entire team helped me be a better Jewish athlete. On the first day of preseason training, I got a big wake-up call of what college basketball was all about. I walk into the locker room, and there's a beautiful locker room. Free Nike clothes that someone folded for you already, and a wooden locker with your name carved out. And I'm thinking to myself, when I was playing at the yeshiva, we didn't even have a locker room. We had to change behind the curtain on the top of the stage. And here I am in a Division I locker room. This is so exciting. I was so excited to put on my practice jersey. There was a senior next to me, his name was Brian Barber. And he looks down at me, 6'7". He says, son, you're excited to put that jersey on? I said, yeah, I've been waiting for this my whole life. He says, you have no idea what you got yourself into. And I don't know, I couldn't understand what he was saying. But I learned very quickly. We went out to the basketball court, and the coach just followed me. We walk off the basketball court, outside, similar to what you have here, down to the football field. And he says, today, we're going to do 8 suicides on the football field. Does everyone know what a suicide basketball drill, where you touch every line? So the football field is much bigger than the basketball court. So we do the first one, and I come back and I'm thinking, wow, that was insane. I've never done anything like that in my life. The second one was crazy. The third one, you have guys 6'8", 6'9", 250 pounds crying in pain. And on the fifth one, one of the players missed a line. Instead of touching the line, he missed it by an inch. So the assistant coach blew the whistle, and he says, "Coach, so-and-so missed the line." Head coach says, "He missed the line? All right. We'll do this whole thing over again, starting at zero." Take a walk around the track, and we're starting again. I'm walking around the track, and I see Brian. And I said, "Brian, coach is joking. I can't physically do eight. I'm not going to make it." He says, "No, he's not joking." He's like, "I told you, you have no idea what you just got yourself into." Walked all the way around, and we did the eight. And that was my first wake-up call. So we did that type of training for about a month straight. And after that, there was something called Midnight Madness. Do you guys have a Midnight Madness here on campus? There was a problem for me, Midnight Madness, my freshman year on campus. It was Friday night, it was Shabbat, and it was a holiday of Sukkot. Everybody knows the holiday of Sukkot, when we Jewish people eat inside the tent, right? So Friday night, I had a big challenge. Muhammad and I lived on the 15th floor, okay? And the Sukkah, where I was supposed to eat, was on the opposite side of campus. Now, you're not allowed to carry on Friday night unless there's something called an Eruv, which would allow a Jewish person to carry. There was no Eruv on campus. Out of 17,000 kids, I was the only person that was going to eat in the Sukkah that night. And I couldn't carry my food into the Sukkah. So Muhammad saw me looking out the window. My bed was closer to the window. And he says, "Why do you keep looking out the window?" I said, "Because I have a little bit of a challenge. I need to eat in that broken down teepee on the other side of campus, and I'm not allowed to carry my food." He says, "No worries." 6'10", takes my tray with my gefilte fish and my grape juice, and we're walking across campus. We're freshmen, okay? All right. Walking into the Sukkah. So I go into the Sukkah, I say, "Muhammad, do you want to sit with me and eat in here?" He's like, "No, man, this is crazy. I'll see you at Midnight Madness." So he walks to the gym, I eat real quick, and then I go to the gym. And every player gets to give a shout out in the microphone. "Oh, we're going to make it to the tournament. I'm going to average 30 points a game, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera." I came out, I was the last player because I was so nervous. I wasn't in uniform. I was wearing my Shabbat clothes. I was wearing a button-down shirt and pants. And the athletic director says, "All right, come meet our new freshman point guard, Tamir Goodman. What do you have to say about the upcoming season?" And tries to hand me the microphone. I whisper in his ear and I say, "Dr. Edwards, I'm sorry, I don't talk on the microphone tonight because it's Shabbat." So he takes the microphone in front of all the fans on Midnight Madness. I'm a freshman. He says, "Actually, Tamir's not going to talk on the microphone tonight like the rest of the players because it's Shabbat." He told that to all the fans. So they got up and they gave me a standing ovation. They said, "Yeah, man, Shabbat, you don't need to talk in the microphone. Way to go." And I got a bigger standing ovation than any player on the team. And that made me feel really comfortable moving forward. So about the fourth or fifth game of the season, we're on the road in Philadelphia. And Muhammad and I are just about to fall asleep. Hear a knock on the door. Go to open up the door. I was shocked to see it was my head coach. "Coach, what's going on? What's going on?" He says, "Look, I want you to be ready to play tomorrow." I said, "I'm always ready to play." "What's special?" He says, "Look, we're playing against Villanova, one of the top teams in the nation. The game's on ESPN, and you're starting." I was a freshman. I was so shooken up that I couldn't sleep all night. I was like, "How am I going to play against Villanova? Like, I'm freezing up here. And the game's on ESPN, and I'm starting." We walk into Villanova, and there was a little Jewish boy. He was 10 years old. He had the worst seats in the stadium. His back was up against the wall. He was in the highest section of the stadium. But he wrote in Hebrew, in a sign that said in Hebrew writing, "Ruchim abayim leTamir," that this little boy wrote, "Welcome to Tamir" in Hebrew. And when I saw his sign, it made me feel so much better, and it gave me confidence to have a great game, and I was able to start the rest of the season. So everything was great. School was great. Muhammad was becoming more and more Jewish every day. But there was only one thing that was hard for him in Judaism. Most things were really easy. When I came back to our dorm room on Friday night, he'd always turn off the radio or the TV, lower it. I had a respect for Shabbat. But one time we were on the road, and after the game, I always had my cooler of kosher food, my parents packed me rugelach. Does everyone know what rugelach are, the healthy Jewish treat that we've been eating for thousands of years? So I start eating the rugelach, and Muhammad says to me, what is that? What are you eating? I said, Muhammad, this is for Jewish people. It's called rugelach. Go ahead, you try one. I'll be right back. I'm going to call my mom. I go down to the lobby. I call her, Ima, everything's good. We're coming back tomorrow. Come back to the hotel room, and Muhammad is passed out on the bed sleeping with an empty bag of rugelach. And the next morning, Coach wakes us up. We need to get back to the airport. We're flying home. But Muhammad can't get out of bed. His stomach is killing him. His body wasn't used to the rugelach. He never ate anything like that in his life. So he said to me, what did you give me to eat last night? I said, Muhammad, rugelach is for Jewish people. Why'd you eat the whole bag? Why'd you eat one? He says, don't ever give me that stuff again. So other than the rugelach, everything was more than good at Towson. A couple of games after that, I'm playing in the game, and there's a loose ball on the floor. Everybody knows college basketball, especially in Indiana. You can't let that ball just roll on the ground like that. You gotta gain possession of the ball. So I dive head first to get the ball. But somebody from the other team also dove head first to get the ball. And not on purpose, but he slammed my head into the floor fighting for the ball, and I got a little concussion. And I just remembered when I got up, everyone was clapping and applauding as if someone just hit a three-point shot. Thinking to myself, what's so funny that this guy slammed my head into the floor? A couple days later, I watched the game tape to see what happened, something very special. My teammate right here, Sam Sutton, he noticed that after I got hurt, they took me off the court to the team doctor on the sideline. But because I hit my head so hard at around half court, my kippah fell off, and my kippah was still on the court. And I was off the court at the team doctor, and Sam said to himself, Tamir can't be without his kippah. And in front of thousands of people, he ran over to half court, picked up my kippah for me. This is in a Division I basketball game, runs all the way over to the sideline, slams it back on my head, and he goes out to play the rest of the game. And that's why they gave a standing ovation. They respected so much that Sam went out of his way to help me so much. So, everybody knows about March Madness, right? Biggest college tournament. So for us at Towson, we made it to our conference semifinal, which meant if we won the semifinal, we played in the championship game. If you win the championship game, you advance to, it's called the Big Dance. Unfortunately, the biggest game of my life, conference semifinal, came out on a Friday night. And immediately I told the coaching staff that even though it was the biggest game of my life, I wasn't going to play. And somehow the media found out about it. These are just some of the headlines from that game. USA Today, Associated Press, this was almost in every newspaper in America. Everybody knew that I wasn't going to play that Friday night. I did a little bit of research, and I found out that there was a hotel right across the street from the arena. So I said, Coach, can you please listen to me? I have an idea. He said, what is it? I said, how about I stay in the hotel right across the street from the arena? I won't stay with you guys. They were 20 minutes away. That way, on Friday night, if Towson won, I could just look in the parking lot. If our fans look happy, we won. If they look sad, then we lost. I'll find a way to get home on Saturday night. And if we win, I could only play half the game on Saturday night because Shabbat didn't end until the second half anyway. He says, no problem. You got it. Then I called up my father, bless him. I said, Pop, this and that. He said, look, I don't want you to spend Shabbat by yourself. I'm going to close my office. I'm going to fly out there and I'm going to meet you. My father got there on Friday afternoon. I was so happy because I was very lonely. Sometimes I travel a week straight without even seeing another Jewish person. My father came and brought the challah and the food. It was so exciting to have Shabbat with him on Friday night. After our services, in our room, we were just about to make Yiddish. We hear a knock on the door. And I thought to myself, wow, maybe there's another Jewish person. Someone saw us. They want to have Shabbat with us. This will be so exciting. Went to open up the door on Friday night, and I was completely shocked to see wasn't another Jewish person. It was my entire team. They stopped the team bus. They didn't go back to their hotel. They said, Tamir, we wanted to let you know that we won the game for you. and we won the game for Shabbat. We respect so much that you didn't play in the biggest game of your life tonight. And that was the highlight of my entire basketball career that Friday night. Saturday night, I ran across the street to the arena. It was halftime. I walked in, the coach was like, is it over yet? I said, yeah, it's over. He said, get changed. Change really quick. I go out there, and as I go to the tunnel, I hear the broadcaster saying, Jewish kid's here. He couldn't play the first half. He has to wait till there's three stars outside. And everyone in the arena was talking about where I was. We were down by like 15. We were down by a lot of points. We had a nice run, but we did not win. Yeah. Shabbat doesn't end until there's three stars outside. When there's three stars outside, that means the Shabbat's over, and I was able to play. I got to the game, though. We were down by a lot. We made a nice run, and unfortunately, we weren't able to win the game. And that ended my freshman year. We had a team banquet, and I was awarded Coach's Award for Best Performance on and off the court, which was really exciting. They told me they were going to build a team around me. And I went home for spring break. Unfortunately, during spring break, I got the worst phone call of my life. My head coach said, Tamir, there's a press conference tomorrow. Bad news. I said, what is it? He said, well, I just didn't want you to read about it in the newspaper, so I'm going to tell you right now. I've just been fired. We don't know why, and our entire staff is gone. Meaning, everyone who helped me for Shabbat is now gone. Spring break, I'm crying my head off because Maryland, the Christian school, everything that I'd gone through, now everything was perfect at Towson, and now coach is gone. And he said, Tamir, I know the new coach who they hired. He's not going to accommodate you like I've accommodated you. You should leave Towson University. I didn't want to leave Towson. I felt like it would be disrespectful after they helped me, and I stayed. And unfortunately, the new coach made it impossible for me to stay there as a Jewish athlete. He would verbally abuse me from day one. He scheduled as many games and practices as possible on Shabbat. And I knew something was really wrong, so I called a meeting with him. He showed up an hour and a half late to the meeting. And nothing was better after that meeting, so I called a meeting with him and the athletic director, which took so much chutzpah for an 18-year-old to do. But I did it, and I said to the athletic director, I don't want to talk bad about coach behind his back, so I'm telling you right now, something's wrong. I don't think the new coach wants me here. Maybe I should leave. And the athletic director put his hand on my hand, and he said, Tamir, I can assure you, everything's going to be fine. In the locker room, after that meeting, first game back, the new coach took a metal stool and he tried to slam it over my head at point blank range. And thank God I moved back so it didn't hit my face, but then he kicked it into me really hard. And the miracle, campus police were right outside the locker room. It busted inside the locker room. And that was my last time that I ever played a game at Towson University. Because I was crushed emotionally, physically, spiritually. I quit basketball, left the team. They let me go to camp, they let me go to school every day. I still had a scholarship, but I was done with basketball and I was just torn to pieces. Several months after the incident, I don't know how, but I woke up and I said, you know what? God puts everybody in this world for a special mission. For me, it's basketball. And if I'm not playing basketball, I'm not alive. I can't let the new coach make me be dead, basically. I'm gonna come back, but I'm gonna come back better than ever. And I got myself back in shape. And I got a phone call from David Blatt, Coach David Blatt. Last year he was coaching the Cleveland Cavaliers, he was LeBron James' coach. Before he was coaching the Cavs, he used to coach in Israel, Maccabi Tel Aviv. And he said to me, Samir, we heard what happened to you. What do you think about playing in Israel? Man, when he told me that, I still get chills. I was so excited because my seventh grade yearbook, everyone got to write what they want to be when they grow up. Lawyer, rabbi, doctor. Mine said, basketball player in Israel. And I got that call from Coach Blatt. I was so excited. He said, perfect. I'll see you in New York for a tryout. I did one tryout with him, 1 hour tryout. And after that tryout, I signed a 3-year contract to play professional basketball in Israel. I was so excited to sign with Maccabi Tel Aviv. It's like playing for the Bulls of the 90s with Michael Jordan on the team. I mean, I didn't even have to go through security at the airport when I landed in Israel. You'll never have to think about paying at any restaurant or anything like that. It's like total celebrity life. but very soon, into my contract, my agent calls me up and he says, I'm sorry to let you know, you've been traded. And still a first division team, but I lost a lot of money, and I went from playing like the best team to not the best team. But I said I'm going to make the best of the situation. This new team that I played for was near Ramat Gan, and this was during the second intifada in Israel. And during the second intifada, there was a lot of victims of terror, kids that were wounded, and they were in the hospital in Ramat Gan, right near where we played. So there's something called National Service. National Service said, there's all these kids that want to meet this American basketball player. Can you come visit the wounded kids in the hospital? I said, sure. I just don't know how to get there. So the lady who was helping me organize it, she said, oh, well, you'll follow us. And do you mind if I bring my friend along? I said, no. I meet her friend. She says, you know, I'm very similar to you. I'm 20, 21 years old. The reason I'm in Israel studying and doing National Service is because an athletic scholarship offers in America. But I didn't want to compete on Shabbat. So instead of competing on Shabbat, I moved to Israel. When she told me that, I said, man, is there any way we could get married? 2 weeks later, we got engaged, and thank God now we have 4 kids. Wow. And I only met my wife, which is the biggest blessing of my life, after I lost the biggest contract, professional contract that I ever had in my career. Sometimes our blessings come to us in a special way. After we got married, I went to fulfill my second dream, which was to go into the IDF. The headline in the newspaper, I don't know if anyone can read it, says Michael Jordan Michel Tzahal. Michael Jordan of the Israeli Army. Why do I have my basketball clothes there? Because every day in the Israeli Army, didn't matter what day it was and what we were doing, my sergeant let me practice basketball for 2 hours a day. Every single day. He was very sweet. So I was able to serve in the Israeli Army and even coach in Israeli Army basketball, which was a great, great experience for me. I'm a certified armored personnel carrier technician in the Israeli Army. So if anyone has a problem with their tanks, just let me know. after I finished my Army service, I told my wife I want to play again. I miss playing professionally. I got myself back in shape, but unfortunately from 2004 until 2009, I never had success again as a player due to all those injuries. Every single year, I got hurt. And in 2009, this is my team in the championship game, and this is me right here dressed in street clothes because I could no longer play basketball due to all the injuries, and I was forced to retire at 27. Most of the articles that came out about my retirement were very negative. Tamir, 2000. You were the MVP of the Capital Classic, 2009, can't even play anymore. You're writing bad things about me. But really, my injuries taught me how to redefine success. They made me much more sensitive and much more creative. Instead of being sad, I was gonna took everything I learned and try to turn it into something positive. First thing is, I want compression fit tzitzit. Imagine Under Armour dry fit tzitzit. So, tzitzit, and they took on really new meaning. During Israel's war, because I remember the tzitzit that the army gave us. They were oversaturated and baggy. I thought, well, what if we gave our soldiers spiritual armor, compression fit, high performance tzitzit? And I raised the money, and we were able to send my tzitzit right now. As we speak, the soldiers in Israel are wearing high performance tzitzit and helping them protect our country. Omri Kaspi, who's now on the Sacramento Kings, we're very close friends. He was the first Israeli to ever play in the NBA. We partnered and started doing a lot of basketball camps and clinics. Till today, I've worked with over 15,000 players. I would have never been able to work with the players and train them the way I do if it wasn't for my injuries. They made me much more sensitive. I have a camp in Jerusalem this summer. If anybody is interested or knows someone that may be interested, you can take a flyer. Then my wife and I wrote this book. I don't know if anybody remembers when Tim Tebow was really big and he was praying on the football field. Does everyone remember that?
Yeah.
So I basically called up Divergent Books and I said, well, you can see spirituality in sport is more popular than ever. Can't you see what Tim Tebow's doing? He said, sounds pretty interesting. I said, well, I could do a book like that for basketball. So that's how I got my book deal, which we have for sale here after I'm done. And then finally,
I was in an open gym. I was in an open gym in Israel after I blew my knee out, and I thought to myself, wow, I'm never going to play again. How can I help the next generation of players? I thought of an idea called Zoma 90. I invented and patented the first ever multi-angle pitchback for basketball. Before my invention, all pitchbacks were one-dimensional. Zoma 90, you can catch the ball from multiple angles and attack the basket just like you would in the game. But in order to do this, I needed to get a testimonial from a major, major basketball guru. And there's somebody named Coach Brendan Sur. He was part of the Dream Team coach in 92, went with Barcelona when Michael Jordan was on the team. He runs a program called Coaching You, trains all these coaches. I said, well, if I get a testimonial from him, then I'll be good to go. But how can I get a testimonial from such a great coach? It was a miracle. As I called him up, he said, you're Jewish, aren't you? I said, yeah. Really? I said, yeah. He said, I'd love to hear what you got in your mind. I just read the book Startup Nation, all about tech coming out of Israel. And he was able, I thought I was going to get 2 seconds with him. He ended up giving me a half an hour and a great testimonial, which has really helped our company. And it just goes to show you should never have, be afraid to show that you have any association with Israel. It's helped you in every way. For me, it's helped me in every way and in this world. So until today, Zoma 90 is now being used in the NBA and top college teams across the nation. I currently live in Jerusalem, Israel, with my wife and 4 kids, so if you ever come to Jerusalem, please track us down. I also work for Hapoel Jerusalem, the top team in Israel, one of the top teams in Israel and in Europe. We just signed Amari Stoudemire. He became the most celebrated NBA player to ever come play in Israel. So I'm working with him now a lot and doing a lot of amazing programs in Israel through sport, using the power of sport to do a lot of good in the world. So although I no longer physically play, the mission of trying to do good through basketball is still going on, and I'm blessed to be able to do that in Israel. And again, before we take any questions, I want to thank everyone here from the bottom of my heart and Hillel International for making as possible, and I think the takeaways are you should know that you're very special in your own way. Go after your dreams, reach your inner potential, find a way to help everyone around you through your own unique blessings, and never be ashamed of who you are. Be proud of who you are, if people only respect that. And if there are challenges along the way, just know they're coming for you to overcome them, not for them to take you down. Thank you very, very much. And blessings.
Open the floor to some questions, and then I know that Rabbi Sue really wants to just say thank you to you afterwards. So,
thank you.
But any questions and just anything goes, well not anything goes, and just, yeah. So then afterwards Rabbi
thank
Sue
you.
Wants to talk.
Sure.
Oftentimes I hear about, in Israel, the tension between secular and observant Judaism. The Jews being a team, or were they very of your observation?
Yeah, it's a very good question. I think in America, it was more like I was showing everyone what Judaism is because I was the only Jew. In Israel, I felt like I broke that barrier down too, but I was unique because in Israel, you have American players that aren't Jewish and Israeli players. And I was able to like bridge the gap between everyone, secular, religious, non-Jewish. And I think for me, I was lucky because I was involved in basketball. Basketball, everything physical in the world has a spiritual energy behind it. And the spiritual energy behind sport, one of the most powerful things about sport is that it unites people. Because religious people love sport, non-religious people love sport, everybody loves sport. And basketball is able to bring that together. And that made it easier for me. And I didn't have to do anything special other than play basketball. So I was lucky. Great question.
Are there any like regrets that you have about looking back on Maryland winning the championship in 2002? Any like part of you that regrets not being a part of that program in any respect, or are you pretty comfortable with the decision you made to turn down Coach Williams?
Yeah, I'm very thankful for the decision that I chose. I don't think I would be here today if I wouldn't have made that decision. I respect Maryland, never said anything bad about them.
But for me personally, you know, every year when someone wins a national championship, they get a new ring, right? They have to make a new ring. They just made one for the Cavs, an amazing ring. But I say, like, every year someone has to get a new ring, but the Shabbat ring is eternal. It's a blessing that lasts forever. It's a blessing that has kept our people together. If it wasn't for Shabbat, there probably wouldn't be Jewish people in the world anymore. And I'm glad that I chose that blessing instead of the championship. Anything else?
First of all, I want to thank you so much for coming
here.
Thank you.
I love your shop, too.
Thank you. Yeah. I mean, personally, coming, spending the majority of my childhood at a modern day yeshiva, you go to the longer high school, the basketball team, and like especially high school basketball, it becomes like the social network of like happenings. And like you, obviously, person Dan, I think more of your actual athletic ability and what you respected of and really admired was what you kind of alluded to earlier today when you referred yourself to as a Jewish basketball player and you wanted to derail the attention away from yourself and more to Judaism as a whole, as a nation. So I guess, what would your advice be to the next generation of Jewish students and Jewish athletes where today's society there's so much pressure to assimilate and really to, I guess, blend in? And like, what would you say, like, how can you focus that attention towards your Judaism and towards using that as a source of personal growth? And
yeah, I think that Judaism is a positive, not a negative. It doesn't take you away from reaching your goals, it only shows you how to get there in a more meaningful way. And for me personally, in my own journey, both during the good times and the bad times, that was the key to success. For example, if I had a really good game, I couldn't be satisfied. This isn't about me, this is about something bigger than myself. I need to get back in the gym and get better. And if I messed up and I like was in a drought or down or depressed, especially after the coach assaulted me, if I was just playing for myself, I probably would have still been depressed, but I wasn't playing for myself. I was like, I can't do this. This isn't about me. I need to pick myself back up because there's work to do here for Am Yisrael. So it was really like the greatest power that I had, because if I was just to play for myself, or if we just do things for our own ego, we're limiting our potential. And I think the world tells us to only focus on ourselves all the time. Everything in this world nowadays is I. But I think one of the most magical things in the world is if we could do something for something bigger than ourselves, because both during the good times and the bad times, we'll have a unique power that other people might not have. And that's why I say it's always been a blessing for me and not something negative. But that's for me, my journey.
Whatever happened with that coach?
He eventually got fired. I dropped the charges. I didn't want to go to court. But my coach who did help me my first year, he ended up coaching Michael Jordan's son at UCF, and he's looking for Jewish players, so just let me know if you need me to introduce you to anyone.
Hey, actually,
there you go.
Is he coaching now?
Yeah, he's coaching Florida at Stetson University. Anything else? Yes?
Yeah, so it sounds like now you're pretty happy with the way things turned out. Twists and turns, but it all turned out okay. Did you feel good during the process? Like, did faith bring you through, or did you feel like you were not going the right direction?
I felt like the same answer of what I said before, because it's not my personality to be in the newspaper or to be talking here in front of people. I like to be quiet and just simple. But once all this came, I said I need to channel it to try to do good. And because it wasn't about me, something bigger than me, it allowed me to do the best I could both during the good times and the bad times. I've seen players that just play for themselves. I've seen it. I've seen them in the locker room. I see what happens to them. It's a pretty scary situation, because oftentimes, like, if they're just playing for the money or for the fame, once you get the money and the fame, nothing else in this world could like give you a stimulation of like excitement. And it's very depressing and makes you very sad. And I've seen that with my own eyes. But for me, it always made me feel like I tried to help them out. But I always felt like, wow, thank God for me, I have like a spiritual journey. And like spirituality has no limit. You could always grow more and more and more. So it was never a negative for me. It was always a positive, both during the good and the bad times. So I hope that answers it a little bit.
Do any other schools agree to your schedule link, or was it just Towson?
Towson like came on so aggressive. They even wrote me in Hebrew Shana Tova, like before Rosh Hashanah, on the card, on the little cards they send you. So I was like, wow, this, they really want to make this happen. That's where I want to be. And that's my advice to young players: go where you're wanted. You know, go where the coach wants you, because that's the only way you're going to develop as a player. You're not gonna, even if you go to a big school, but the coach isn't really into you, you're not really going to go that far. You know?
So I've got a question. I'm not sure exactly details in sports marketing and all of that. Last year on our birthright trip, we had a student, Andrew Shapiro. He's now actually working in Chicago for the basketball team.
Good for the Bulls. He's done the Bulls really well. For Michael Jordan's team, like for the other Jordan. Yeah. Like the team that he made famous. But anyway, and when we were on birthright, he would have killed, but he would have like done anything to get a proper Maccabi Tel Aviv shirt, and it was his goal in life to go work there and this and that, and I'm sure Nye's happy when he's doing it at the Bulls. I don't want to bring that. But anyway, so he was in sports marketing, and there are probably a lot of people here in sports marketing, and they want to go into careers, whether it's Maccabi Tel Aviv or other teams in Israel, and I'm sure with the Bulls and the Pacers and the Knicks. And what's your advice to them how to get a career? Because if I remember correctly, you told me earlier that you're working with Jerusalem's basketball team, and you're like, not in the front office, but you're doing marketing. Or,
right.
Like, how do these guys get the break?
Yeah, I think sometimes in the sports world, you look at a lot of the GMs and the coaches, they've worked their way up in the system. I think in sports, you could actually do it pretty quickly, quicker than in other professions. Just get in the door, it doesn't matter what you're doing, breaking down the video, sweeping the floor, whatever, just get part of the team, and then once you get in with the team, you could build your way up. And I tell everybody, if there's any way that you think I can help you in your journey in sports marketing, or if any of my contacts could help you, please email me, Tamir@TamirGoodman.com, or any type of social media. However you feel like I can help you, I always try to help anyone who emails me. So you have me, if that could help anyway. But I say get in the door and build your way up. Okay?
Did you have any contact or ever talk with Aaron Lieberman when he played at Northwestern? Because
yes.
He was also a player who wore a kippah, but unlike you, if I remember correctly, I think he did, or he was willing to play on Shabbat.
Yeah.
Was that ever something that you talked to him about, and what would you say, what did you say to him, or what would you say to players who are kind of debating whether or not they want to or don't want to play on Shabbat?
Yeah, I've been in touch with his parents throughout the process. I can't talk for other people, I can only say for myself that Shabbat's been a blessing for me and for my basketball, and it's helped my basketball. You know, during the week we're like going full speed ahead, focusing on our physical body, but it's like sometimes we need to like, I feel like for me, I need to focus a little bit on my spiritual and my soul in order to be overall healthy. And so for me, it's always been a blessing, but I can't judge other people or talk what I think other people should do. You know, everyone has their own unique relationship with this world. So I can just say for myself, it's always been a blessing. So if you want to ask me privately, you can ask me or email me or anything, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, if there's anything I could ever do. And if you come to Jerusalem, I'd love to see you guys, and I wish you all the blessings in the world. Thank you very, very much.
Can you stick around? Can you stick around just for 2 minutes, if you don't mind? So I've just got one more question, and then Sue wants to say very, very short, brief words. So who's one of the best 13-year-olds that you've had use Zone 190 that you can remember in your most recent memory?
Nathan.
So Nathan was playing with Zone 190. I've actually got a video which will be on our Facebook page very soon. But what do you think of Zone 190? And Nathan, actually, I've heard a rumor, I'm not sure from who, it could be the guy next to him with red hair, but that he's actually was number 15 or 16 rated 13-year-old in Indianapolis last year. But what do you think of Zone 190?
Like, how did you enjoy it?
Pretty fun.
What? Okay. So, just one, like, how did it work for you?
So, I just wanted to say on behalf of Hillel and everybody here, thank you so much. This was, I've been at Hillel, as he said, for 27 years. I think this is one of the best, one of the best conversations that I've heard or talks that I've heard, because to see somebody who is so proud of who they are and how Judaism is such an integral part of your life, because day after day I talk with a lot of people who aren't sure how to integrate their Judaism into their lives and struggle with that. And I think being an American means struggling with the question of how to integrate Judaism into your life. You can't be an American Jew and not struggle with that, and to see how you've done that, while it may not work for everybody in the room, I think it's incredibly inspirational. I'm so proud of who
thank
you are.
Thank you so much.
So thank you so much.
It's been so great to work with you guys.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I just want to thank, first of all, now that you've embarrassed me completely, I actually want to thank his father, Mark Hoffman. The reason that we were able to have you here today is because we have a few very generous people who've helped us to have Yotam here as our Israel fellow, and it was through Yotam being here that we were able to work with Hillel International to bring Tamir Goodman. So, Mark, thank you very much for Pavilion Properties for making this.
And then also at the same time, we'd really like to thank this silent, anonymous, very generous donors in Indianapolis that have helped us together with Hinenu to bring Yotam and make that possible, because otherwise we wouldn't have been able to do it. And then we also really wanted to thank Becca Creeth and Charlene Brown, because they've had a hell of a busy day with about three other events, a lunch, and from the Hutton Honors College for sharing their venue. And thank you so much for doing that.
You had mentioned something about maybe that there may be some opportunities if the students are interested in the basketball thing that you do in Israel.
Yeah.
So I would just say that if they are interested, there is a free trip to Israel called Birthright Israel if you haven't already been, and you could go there and then and maybe be involved.
Can
in
they get
in
internships with Jerusalem?
I could try. I can't promise, but I could try. I can. When you come to Israel, take you around, show you the new arena, show you what professional basketball is like in Israel, show you some of the amazing work we do in the community in Israel. Anything I could do personally, I would love to help.
And then also, actually, earlier today, I was talking to Tamir, and for Megan and Sue, Tamir said that he would facilitate that our summer birthright groups, both buses, can go on a tour of Jerusalem.
Oh, that'd be amazing.
Yeah.
So if you're interested in birthright, down the road with us this summer, it is a way, if there is something they can do with internships in the summer, you can travel to Israel with us on Birthright Israel, and then you can extend your trip, so you have a free trip to Israel if you're eligible for Birthright. You have a free trip to Israel and then could stay to do whatever it is that you would do. And then we wanted, most importantly, I know you said that Indiana basketball has been important to you, but I don't think you got the official Hebrew Indiana hat. And the Hebrew Indiana t-shirt.
Thank you. And for this, you've got to open in front of everybody, and you've got to guess what it is. It's going to be something you've always wanted.
Basketball.
Basketball, that's it.
You guys are so cool. Oh wow, it's so nice. Thank you.
It's gonna be his first Big Ten championship.
Thank you.
From last year when Indiana University won the Big Ten, if you didn't get it with Maryland, now you've got your Indiana University.
Thank you. I'm gonna give you guys a copy. I do it in my library. So a copy of my book for your library.
Thank you so much.
all the way around. Switch hands. Left, all the way in the middle, all the way around. Nice, all the way in the middle, all the way around. Great job. Now left hand. Middle, all the way around. Fantastic. One more time. Good. Middle, all the way around. Fantastic. Left hand. Drive the ball, throw it off the right.
Wow.
This side. One, two, three, four. Throw it off the left side. It's a little 90. Shot. V cut. Shot. V cut. Good. Great job. Curl cut. Alright. Curl in. Curl. Nice job. Feet all the way out to here. Shot. Feet out. Good. Feet cut off.